the morning star, drive 117.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the morning star, drive, you know.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's Monday, September 6th, and this is the Morningstar Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and support us on Patreon. So it is a wonderful Monday. We got coronavirus updates, current news from around the world, the Sunday sermon, the message about a spiritual and divine person, and of course a new segment every Monday, Korean on the Go with Preston Lewis in Korea. So how are you guys doing? It is a very special and wonderful day for me. For those who don't know, September 6th is a special day because it is my birthday. Woo! Happy birthday to me. Yes, I have turned 43 today and I'm super thankful and happy. I got to call my parents tonight. They're still in Vancouver. Oh, by the way, I'm in LA now. So just 2 days ago, I drove from San Francisco over. No, not 2 days ago. It was on Friday. It's Monday, so it was like 3 days ago, right? So on Friday, I drove from San Francisco. It was about a 6.5-hour drive. And, I could have flew because the price is basically the same. However, I just wanted to have some, like, you know, when you just need some alone time. And I just wanted to drive, reflect, and, you know, like basically karaoke in the car, singing my heart out to boy band songs and stuff. So I came into LA. I'm now here at my uncle's house. So and I'm very familiar with my uncle here because I used to live here for about 4 years when I was coming to school here way back in 1998. So super grateful and thankful that I'm over here right now and very, very comfortable. And I'm happy. My birthday. I'm in Los Angeles right now, having a very, very good time, having a lot of good coffee. It's a little bit more expensive than Malaysia, but it's still good coffee. All right, so how was your weekend, guys? How were you guys doing? I'm sure you guys are able to enjoy your weekend, rest, receive grace and fire. How about that Sunday message, guys? That message was deep. I had to listen to some parts of it again. And it's already Monday, and we can restart another amazing week together with the Lord. We're gonna go over the Sunday message a little bit later, too. So thanks for joining us here. Make sure to like and comment below. Whether it's on YouTube or SoundCloud, want to hear how you guys are doing, make your requests, questions, or what you guys think about the segments. Also, last week on Thursday night over here in America, Friday for you in Asia, the Espresso with Sky channel came out with a new video. It's about if children don't believe in God, do they go to hell? Right, so it's actually a big question that a lot of people want to ask, but they can't really ask because it's a very, very tough question, right? So I made this channel a little bit more spiritual so that it can be something that you can share with your newcomers, your parents and family, but also you can learn tune the logic and reasoning behind it and how to talk to newcomers. Yesterday, a new Sunday edition came out. We interviewed Joycelyn Sin from Singapore. Great interview, guys. I'm super thankful. She is someone, she's been working more than a year in the pandemic, and she's been like, yeah, so she's been one of those frontliners. So really grateful and thankful to her for all the work she's done. Go ahead, check out that interview this week. Big shout outs to Manaka, Mari, and Meg from Japan for supporting us here on Patreon, for believing and supporting this channel. And also through, you know, all the support we get is actually financing and supporting the YouTube channel for all the editors and stuff like that too, all right? So if you want to support us too, then check out the Patreon link in the description. And if you're on SoundCloud, click the blue button on the homepage. Patreon is a crowdfunding site. You can support the Morningstar Drive at just $3 a month, which is way cheaper than Netflix. And at this moment, we have lecture training videos on the site. And Monday Bible studies, Zoom Bible studies will resume. I'm just not sure when because I'm in discussion with the head leaders over here in America. So go ahead and check that out. Also, Monday open Bible studies. I am hoping, though, for these Monday open Bible studies that I'll be able to start it again within I'm hoping by the end of this month, which is within the next 2 weeks. Either way. All right, so let's move into the music. We got the feature artist of the day. Who is it today? It is Man and Groom from the Paper Music Associates in Korea. My favorite song right now. It is called Cold Summer. And after that, we'll have Sunday Boys from America with another bumpin' song. That's going to be Together with the Lord featuring Mariah Henry. And last but not least, we have Renee Lai from Taiwan with Head Above Water, which is a cover from, what's her name? The Canadian singer Avril Lavigne. All right, guys. Hope you guys really are enjoying these new, but these podcasts. And everyone have a wonderful time listening to this music from members, artists from around the world. And make sure you keep them all in your prayers.
Do it. 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 Do but we are on different levels.
From Taiwan with Head Above Water. That's a cover from Avril Lavigne, a singer in the past from, not Korea, from Canada. Before that, Somebody Boys from America with Together with the Lord featuring Mariah Henry, and of course Man and Groom from PMA in Korea with Cold Summer. So let's get into some news going on around the world. We're going to start off with the coronavirus updates. 221.2 million cases with 4.57 million deaths, and the mortality rate once again has dropped to 2.06%. Top five countries going by daily infection rates and daily death rates. We have the US on top, 58,000 cases in a day with 576 deaths. India, 42,000 cases, 311 deaths. The UK, 37,000 cases, 120 deaths. Brazil, 21,000 cases, 609 deaths. And then the Philippines ranked in the top five with 20,000 cases and 515 deaths in a single day. Over here in North America, where I'm at right now, the U.S., of course, is on top. We have Mexico with 17,000 cases and 725 deaths, and Canada doing really well. Only 1,900 cases with 10 deaths in a single day, so that is great news. So let's go into the top three news going on around the world. We'll start off kind of another update with what's going on with Hurricane Ida over there in Louisiana. That was a hurricane Category 4 that came in with 240 kilometer an hour winds, and basically the state of Louisiana is grappling with power outages as Hurricane Ida death toll rises. So hundreds of thousands remain without power in Louisiana after Hurricane Ida brought extreme winds and flooding to the U.S. state. Still reeling in the wake of Hurricane Ida, people in the U.S. state of Louisiana now face the challenge of finding generators or fuel to power them amid continuing power outages, as one energy company warned that it could take weeks to fully restore electricity to hard-hit areas. Now, the extreme winds from Ida, which made landfall in Louisiana as a Category 4 hurricane last weekend, knocked out power to more than 1 million homes and businesses across the state before bringing torrential rains and flooding to New York, New Jersey, and surrounding areas. Many Louisiana gas stations remain without power, keeping them from operating and making it harder for residents to fill generators. Full restoration of electricity to some hardest hit areas of the state could take until the end of the month, the head of energy Louisiana said on Saturday. So Ida damaged or destroyed more than 22,000 power poles, and that's more than Hurricanes Katrina, Zeta, and Delta combined. So at least 5,200 transformers failed and nearly 26,000 spans of wire, the stretch of transmission wires between poles, were down. Now, as of Saturday morning, power had been restored to more than 327,000 customers, and about a quarter of New Orleans residents have had power restored, including all the city's hospitals and the city's 27 substations that are ready to serve customers. But the death toll is continuing to rise. So Hurricane Ida death toll in Louisiana rose to 9 people on Saturday. That's 9 in hurricane. That's like the center where the worst damage was. But that's only 9 compared to New York and New Jersey, which weren't ready for it. And the northeastern states started their Labor Day holiday weekend digging through debris left by the deadly deluge that killed more than 44 people in those areas, right? So that's pretty crazy. The death toll right now is already, if you combine the two, it's over 50 people. It's like 53 people already right now. And there's probably more to come at this time. Second in the news, we talked about this last week, also was the Canadian elections right now. So the Conservatives are now under fire for over gun control. So Conservative leader faces mounting questions about promise to overturn a 2020 ban on some assault-style weapons such as an AR-15. So Conservative leader Aaron O'Toole has been pressed repeatedly this week over his campaign promise to overturn last year's prohibition on weapons such as the AR-15, which was used by a gunman to kill 26 adults and children in the Sandy Hook massacre in the United States in 2012. Now, gun control is a very sensitive issue in the country, especially in the French-speaking province of Quebec, where several deadly mass shootings have taken place over the past decades. And in the aftermath of a deadly attack in the Atlantic province of Nova Scotia last year, Trudeau, the Prime Minister, in May announced a ban of more than 1,500 models and variants of assault-style firearms, including the AR-15. And Liberal governments have, over the years, tightened gun control laws in Canada, but some Conservative voters complain the measures are too restrictive and needlessly penalize farmers and hunters. So on Saturday, O'Toole told reporters in Vancouver that it was very upsetting to see Mr. Trudeau trying to import American-style politics, particularly on an issue of public safety. So the Conservatives have been making gains in recent weeks as Trudeau's decision to trigger a snap election 2 years earlier than scheduled angered some voters. And the Liberal leader, who had hoped his government's handling of the coronavirus pandemic would lead the party to a renewed majority in Parliament, has also faced large crowds of anti-masking and anti-vaccine protesters on the campaign trail. And last but not least, a third of the world news going on. We'll go back to Afghanistan. And the Taliban break up women's rights protests in Kabul, and Taliban officials have broken up a demonstration by dozens of women in Kabul demanding rights following the Taliban takeover in Afghanistan. And the group say the Taliban targeted them with tear gas and pepper spray as they tried to walk from a bridge to the presidential palace. But the Taliban maintain the protest got out of control, according to Afghan media outlet Tolo News, and it's the latest of several protests by women in Kabul and Herat. Now, the women were calling for the right to work and to be included in the government. And the Taliban say they will announce the makeup of their administration in the coming days. The Taliban have said women can be involved in government but not hold ministerial positions. And many women fear a return to the way they were treated when the Taliban were previously in power between 96 and 2001. And women were forced to cover their faces outside, and harsh punishments were meted out for minor transgressions. So on Saturday, U.S. General Mark Milley questioned whether the Taliban would be able to transition from an insurgent force to a government, saying there was a good probability of civil war. Last but not least, let's get into some sporting news. We're going to start off with college football. Those of you guys who don't know, college football is huge in America. I love college football too. We're on week one and some great games happened. We're going to start off with an awesome game between Georgia, ranked 5 in the nation, versus Clemson, ranked 3rd. Clemson is a massive powerhouse, and so is Georgia. And Georgia beat Clemson 10-3, so the first upset of the week. Alabama, number 1 in the country, they just demolished Miami, which is ranked 14th, 44-13. Another great game was Penn State, ranked 19, versus Wisconsin, ranked 12th. And Penn State upsets Wisconsin 16-10. And last but not least, the biggest upset of the day was UCLA. Not even ranked in the top 25. They beat the LSU Tigers 38-27, and LSU is ranked 16th in the nation. So that's great news for them. And Chip Kelly over there, the head coach. In women's tennis, another upset. Shelby Rogers, the last American left in the U.S. Open, upsets the number one ranked player in the world, Ash Barty, in 3 sets at the U.S. Open. And Rogers rallied down from 5-2 in the 3rd set to upset Barty 6-2, 1-6, 7-6 at Arthur Ashe Stadium for the biggest win of the 28-year-old's career. Last but not least, we have the NBA news. DeAndre Jordan intends to sign with the Los Angeles Lakers after the trade buyout. Detroit acquired Jordan, 4 second-round picks, and $5.78 million in a deal with Brooklyn on Friday with the intention of buying out the remaining 2 years and $20 million on Jordan's contract. Once the buyout agreement is signed, Jordan will have to clear waivers before becoming a free agent and signing with the Lakers. But his contract terms make it virtually impossible for Jordan to be claimed by a team. And Brooklyn, in return, received Jahlil Okafor and Sekou Doumbouya in the deal with Detroit. And the Nets announced Saturday they will send the Pistons their 2022 and 2027 second-round picks, along with the more favorable 2024 second-rounder between the Washington Wizards and Memphis Grizzlies, and the more favorable 2025 second-rounder between the Wizards and Golden State Warriors, sources said. So that is the news going on for today. Hope you guys really enjoyed that. Yes, that is worldly news from around the world, which means we're going to go into the golden time. Yes, it is. We're going to have a time of praise and worship together with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Trinity. Yes, we're going to start off with the person of mission running for Providence. Then the Lord is so cool, and then we'll break things down with for whom did I come. So with one as one body of the Morning Star Drive, let's spend this time giving praise, honor, and glory to the Holy Trinity.
Go out and run today, and tomorrow you will fly, preaching and preaching again with a heart of purpose. How many years passed since the day you left your hometown? Turn away from the world, time to run, time to fly. Give all of your youth, it won't be in vain. Turn away from the world, rapture now, live with love. Give your youth, it won't be in vain. You who
supplies. Reach to Korea today, then go preach to all the world. Providence life is the best. It is always worthwhile. How many years passed since you left from the former faith? Now turn toward the world. Time to run, time to fly. If you give all of your youth, it won't be in vain. Now turn toward the world. Rapture now, live with love. Give your youth. On the rough seas of life, you sail the Arctic Sea. Now today sail all the world. Strong winds and waves always come on the vast wide oceans. How many years passed since you came to the new history? Turn away from the storms. Time to run, time to fly to the new history. Heaven here on earth. Turn away from the storms. Rapture now, live with love. Give your youth, it won't be in vain.
this dismal world. Whom do you think I came here for? Whom do you think I struggled for? For whom does the bell toll? It was for you, you believe, you who love me and follow. I've come into this dismal world. Whom do you think I came here for? Whom do you think I struggle for? For whom does the bell toll? It was for you, you believe, you who love me and follow. No hesitation, no doubt, no thinking whether I should take action, rather I swung the sword fearlessly. No hesitation in one single strike. From the east to the west, from the north to the south, fast as lightning. Heaven soared, massive and mighty, great and low. With one strike I swung this great sword of the world. Realize, follow me and believe. God has surely sent the Lord. It is I. Quickly, you must believe. Follow, for the time is passing. Once the time has passed by, it will never come back. You must believe. The Lord has come again. Time that's past is already dead now. You must make history that will remain. Let's create what's eternal. The Lord our God never rests His gaze, but with fiery eyes of love He watches over all of us. You all, so I ask, please fulfill my will.
And there you have it. For whom did I come? That's a really Shimjonic song. Hope that everyone really enjoyed that, giving that time of praise and worship. The Lord is so cool before that, and the person of mission running for Providence. All right, so let's get into the word study for today. We have a big, hefty word study because there's just so much that was going on during that Sunday message. And I think we're going to have to, everyone's going to have to listen to that one again because it was so, it was really, really powerfully deep. So I hope that everyone here is really going to think about it, go over your notes, and look at what different realizations we had. And I think one thing that we have to take into consideration when Sunseem talks about Sunday messages, I know that a lot of times we're trying to figure out like, oh, you know, what's the whole message about? But of course, the best advice Sunseem ever gave when it comes to Sunday messages, he said that every message, you just got to listen for that one thing. right? Just that one thing you realize, or that one thing that you want to take action on. And he says, if you can just do one, you know, because there's so many things in the Sunday message, it is impossible to put all of it into action. There's just too much, right? So he says, just find that one thing in every Sunday message and change that one thing every week. Like, let that become your goal. And if you do it like this, then what's going to happen? You're going to change and put into action 52 things in a year, which is, if you think about that, imagine changing 50 things or taking action on 50 things a year. That's crazy, right? So if anything else, this week's message, a spiritual and divine person. We have a lot of things to think about, of course, but there is a core message before anything else. Okay. And of course, it's about loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, will, whatever it is, right? It's Matthew 22, 37 to 40 and the complete Testament Bible scripture too. So that is the key more than anything else. Now, the first one that I was really, really inspired by was the conducting psalm. Right? So it's basically what Sunstein was talking about. He's like going, the first generation, when they were young, God called them and he made providence through them, and they turned their backs on their hometown and they just ran, right? In the early days of providence, like Sunstein was talking about himself, he just ran like crazy, right? Not thinking about anything else, not thinking about consequences in the future. He just ran, right? And this is why providence was able to be like it is right now. And he said he ran to the point he couldn't run like that anymore. And he said it was a very, very lonely path. And the one thing I really enjoyed is when he said this, it reminded me, you know, of course, obviously we're not running like Sunstein, but it reminded me of my past too. You know, today is my 43rd birthday, which means I've been in Providence for like 23 years. So I came to Providence, I started studying when I was 19. And then I passed when, just a few months later when I turned 20, like literally in the same month as I turned 20. So I've been in Providence for 23 years and I've lived outside of Providence for 20 years. So it's pretty incredible that I've been in Providence longer than I've been living. Longer than I've been outside of Providence. But it made me think a lot about the old times for myself too. I remember in campus, people like, you know, I was going to full-time school. Plus, I was doing part-time work. Plus, I was doing like running all the rest of my time, just running in Providence. And I was like, wow, it's something that I really couldn't do right now anymore. Was it a lonely path? I would say, how lonely would it have been? Obviously, it's not as lonely as Sunstein's path because, you know, he was literally alone. But I'd say the loneliest part would just be that it was lonely as in we had this amazing word and we were preaching the gospel so much to people, all, you know, teaching people all the time, but no one really accepted it. And that was kind of that lonely feeling, like no one else cares and nobody else wants this. And you're like, what? This thing is so amazing. And that was kind of like the more of the lonely path that I took, but I had many people around me, right? And, you know, and the crazy part is I passed in Los Angeles. So I'm back in LA right now for my 43rd birthday. And thinking about the past, I was here when I first came to Providence, was in LA in 1998. So I was like, wow, it's really, really amazing how time has flown this quickly. So Sunstein was saying that he was just thinking about how he made history and that thinking about all the past and the lonely things that he went through. And this is how he made this song. And he said all the tribulations and difficulties they came were like waves in the sea. It was just endless tribulation. And honestly, it's still endless. And what's even crazier is right now, when I was thinking about what Sunstein was saying, like it's still going. And he's the one that's still at the front lines. And it's still going over and over and over again. So it's pretty incredible that he's the one continuously just running no matter what. And he said that the amount of difficulty in the past was the same as sailing in a small boat 10 times around the world. And I'm like, wow. Like, that's incredible. So just that first part of the conducting was really, really, it was really inspiring for me just thinking about the past too. Also, you know, now we get into the Sunday message itself. Of course, Sunstein said, we need to learn one thing at a time. So please, you know, he says, don't forget what I teach. And, you know, we know, guys, that beginning thing. Wow, that beginning part of the message was just piercing. It was really piercing just to hear what God was saying. And, you know, Sunstein started off pretty easy with like, oh, you know, write things down. Don't forget. You know, it's easy to forget things. And those who record down the words of God are blessed. And you're, you know, so, and he says, recording is such an important thing. So at that point, I felt kind of good. Like, okay, I'm recording things on YouTube and my podcast, right? And then Sunstein was talking about, you know, he recorded the word of God most out of any person in the world, probably in history, right? And he used more than 4,000 pens. And we have all these, you know, proverbs and poems and songs. There's just so many things. And he says that, you know,
the word passes by so quickly, we're not going to remember everything. So we need to record it or we're not going to remember it. And this is kind of interesting because it reminded me of the time where Sunseem was like, don't write anything down. Don't write your notes. You should be so focused on the word. But of course, you know, Sunseem's talking about in moderation where, you know, the right mentality and attitude. Should we be? Yeah, we should be that focused, but people are too focused on writing things down rather than being focused on the word. So you're just only worried about writing every word down, which is not the right way to do it. But on the flip side is, you know, it doesn't mean, you know, we're gonna forget easily. So you can't just, you know, you can't just sit there and like not write anything down because we're gonna forget. So there's a fine balance within it. And Sunseem gave that example. And it's so crazy because he's getting this all from his personal experience. When he talked about in the morning, he received one proverb and he forgot on the way to the 316 Memorial Hall. But then he remembered it because he wrote it down and put it in his pocket. And it was like the one purpose why God comes is because this is the earth that he has created it. Right? That he's created. So he says, I can deliver this because I recorded it, even though he forgot. So we have to remember and we have to memorize, right? And he says, there's like 25 of the proverbs received and he's going to deliver it, you know, obviously at the end of the message too. So it says, if you forget, you won't have any strength. And he says that 70 to 80% of the people forget because he didn't record it down. So we have to be those that record everything down. But we can't lose the focus of the whole reason why we're doing it in the first place. So, you know, people want to be spiritual without, you know, it's like this week's message, right? We'll go straight into the message about people wanting to be spiritual, people wanting to be divine, but they want to do it without praying. And this is where it gets really piercing in our hearts, right? So people want to be spiritual without even being close to God. And people don't have any idea what it means to be spiritual. You know, what does it mean to be able to communicate with angels and God or the Holy Spirit, right? And that's, you know, that's what it means to be spiritual, to communicate with God and the Holy Spirit. So, gosh, and it went into like presidents and leaders of nations, and they're not going to meet just anyone because when they meet someone, they're giving some of their power to them, right? So when you talk to someone, you're giving your power to them, right? As you speak to them, as you try to solve their issues, you're giving power. Right? So we have to understand is these great people in powerful positions don't just meet anyone because when they meet, they're giving their power. In the same way too, if you want to be spiritual and divine, we need to be connected to God, the greatest, right? And in order to be connected to God, the great person that he sends has to appear, right? And to meet that person, you have to understand how incredibly difficult it is to meet such a person, right? Because if we do, then we become divine also, right? Because when we meet that person, we believe and follow, we receive the words. And like it says, I believe it's in like John chapter 10, verse 33 to 35, it says, those who receive the words of God, right? Those who receive the words of God are the ones that become divine, or in other words, it says to become like God, which is a really, really powerful verse, right? So to meet the person that God sends makes us divine. Now, you know, Paul, you know, it was just, you know, of course, we're getting closer and closer to the piercing message about prayer, right? And, you know, loving the Lord your God is the first and greatest commandment, but we're talking about prayer, okay? And this communication that we're supposed to have with God. And Sunseem was talking straight up about, like, when you pray, how come no one cries, right? You've received salvation and rapture, and you don't even cry when you pray. And basically God said that, you know, Sunseem told God that, you know, I'm going to change them, I'm going to help them to change. And God's like, only 50 to 60% are like really in that, you know, really thankful, really just so grateful to God. It says only 50 to 60%. So he says, why, you know, how can you receive the rapture and not be thankful, right? And then God is like, how can I give the kingdom of God to such people like this? And Sunseem was saying that in the past, he would cry to the point he lost weight praying, just all the tears that he lost. And he's like, you know, can you imagine realizing that you're going to live in a world forever, this type of world, the greatest world with God, and yet we're not that grateful? And Sunseem's like, you know, I pray every evening, 7 to 9 p.m. And then I pray in the pre-dawn. But he's like, no, but it's not just about these two times. If you really, really love someone, would you only talk to them two times a day, or would you talk all the time? And it's like, Yeah, this is something that, you know, even for me as a lecturer, I've taught this type of thing too, but it's exactly what Sun Sim said. If you forget, you will die, right? We need to be faithful to the point of death and just continually pray, right? More than anything else. And oh, what was, you know what, the so inspiring thing when Sun Sim told God that his wish is to live loving God and praising him forever. Like, tell me that's an incredible wish that you would never would have thought of. It was really, really inspiring. And I really, when you're looking at the screen, you can see like the sincerity, the depth in his heart, how much he truly, truly believes in what he says. So, you know, this, you know, we have to realize that Sun Sim is praying for all of us, right? And he really wants all of us to change. And he, if we change, our fate will change. But if we don't change, our fate changes also for the worst. So if we understand what it really means to rapture, and this is incredible too, because, you know, we become one with God. Like, we become husband and wife. And as the Bible says in what verse is that? Is it Matthew chapter 19, verse 5? It says that when a husband and wife, they become one flesh, right? The two become one. And if we are husband and wife, bridegroom and bride with God, yeah, that's exactly the meaning. If you rapture, it means you become one with God. You become one flesh. So we need to pray more. We need to be more thankful. We need to pray to the point our body wears out, and we have to cry to the point that God tells us to stop crying. But we don't cry, and a lot of us don't even pray. So, and then Sun Sim even said, even those of you that do pray, you just murmur, and God will not receive that type of prayer. And it's like, yeah, we have to think about that deeply. What types of prayer is God going to receive? And remember, we're praying to the Almighty God. And the greatest example that Sun Sim gave was, imagine you have your mom and dad willing to solve your problems and talk to you, and you're just, they're like, what is going on? Like, it's such a sad thing. Even before your parents, which isn't even God, you wouldn't do that. But how much more should we pray before God? So we have to understand we're coming before God the Almighty, the omnipotent, omniscient God. And we have such bad habits. So stop murmuring. Don't just, you know, fall asleep, because we're talking before the great Almighty God. We need to speak clearly as if we're communicating to someone in front of us, right? So if the prayers are not delivered, you know, think about it. If we murmur, then the angels will not take those prayers to God. So here's the interesting part is, you know, I was really thinking about this part too, about prayer, because I remember in Christianity, in the former faith, it's always like, you know, it's like, hey, you know, it doesn't matter. You know, as long as you sit there in front of God, you're fine. And it's just, the difference is basically the relationship of children and your lover. So if you have children and they murmur to you a bit, like, oh, that's kind of cute, right? And you're like, hey, and you're trying to teach them to speak better because they're just children. But when it comes to your husband or wife, like if you heard, like, your wife was my wife was constantly murmuring to me, I couldn't understand her, I'd be so frustrated at a certain point, right? I'd be so frustrated. And Sun Sim's like, you know, don't pray like this, because I never taught you this way. And Sun Sim always taught us, and we always complain. Some people are like, oh, I don't want to pray out loud. But this is the way Sun Sim is teaching us the proper way to pray. Oh, I don't want to pray because I want people to hear. I don't want this. If you think about this really clearly, this is the way that God wants us to pray. But a lot of us are kind of hindered by our own, like, being self-conscious more than anything else, when we don't realize this is the way God wants us to pray, right? Clearly, sincerely, petitioning, right? So that God's not frustrated. So, you know, he even talked about Old Testament people like David praying to the point his bed was wet with tears, right? So it's like, isn't it so sad that you guys bought a church so you guys can go and pray inside the church, but instead you just murmur in your prayers? He says, speak clearly. Well, you know, got to pray with that earnestness. You got to pray super clearly. You know, most people just, you know, we have to do it to the point where every word is enunciated and you are so deliberate with every word. You know, sometimes when you pray for your friends, like, oh, thank God for this food, and you kind of forget what you said, you got to be deliberate with your words. Like, you're choosing your words to say clearly in front of God, right? And we need to do that with all our heart, will, and life. And, you know, it's like in the same way, like Sun Sim gave an example of, like, if someone you love so dearly passes away, do you just murmur and not cry? No, you weep and wail. And it says, in the same way, this is how you should pray. Sun Sim said that one time he prayed and cried for 21 days when he realized that Jesus shouldn't have died on the cross. Right? And it was to the point that Jesus told Sun Sim, stop crying. Because both of us are tired, right? of how crazy that is. So just thinking about that was really incredible too. So we need to learn how to pray. Like, well, get back to, come back to our senses. You know, the pandemic did do a number on us, but it's time to get back. Come to our senses and really pray in the right way. God's providence is not a providence of murmuring and not speaking clearly. We need to do it the way God has taught us. You know, we can't complain like, oh God, I don't want to do it like this. I'd rather do, I pray better like this. No, like we were even taught, don't pray in tongues. Speak clearly. But thinking about like the former faith and the old way is a lower level, right? We have to go to the level of brides more than anything else. Like, so Sussman even got to the point, he says, if you pray like that in murmuring, then it's because of sin. Right? Adam and Eve couldn't speak because of the sin of ignorance. So, you know, is, you know, Sunsi did clarify it. We're not saying that, oh my gosh, you have sin, so that's why you can't, that because of that sin, like you have the fall or you have this sin or that sin, that's why you can't pray properly. But it's like when Sunsi gave the example of Adam and Eve, the sin was a sin of ignorance because they didn't know, right? So everyone starting from today, which means from today's pre-dawn, I hope you guys had a really, really good prayer time. We can't pray like that. Right? We have to pray to the point your prayer can be recorded. Like you can record your prayer and send to someone else. So we have to pray really clearly. So yeah, that was something that was really striking to me too. It really was. And I hope that's something that all of us here too can really think about also at that level. Right? So then we went into, of course, this week's message is about to love the Lord your God with all your heart, will, and life. And of course, it's talking about loving God, right? Like loving the Holy Trinity and loving the people around you. So the spiritual people are those that love God with all their heart, will, and life. And that is a number one thing. And so it seems like I get 15 to 16 visions when he prays. He prays about something and he sees it in a vision, right? So if you can't be spiritual and divine, how can you receive the kingdom of God? Right? When that place, the kingdom of God, is a spiritual and divine place. You can't live in the world that is spiritual and divine if you are not spiritual and divine, right? And the example was, it's like going to an English nation without speaking English. It's just not, you're not going to connect and it's not going to make any sense, right? And then he talked about the rapture. And I love this point because it's something that we taught before 2012 and 13, when something would taught the deeper level of the rapture. But it's a misunderstanding that the rapture happens only once. But we have to realize it's a continuous happening, right? So we're like going, oh, wait, wasn't the rapture, you know, March 16th, 2015? And the answer is yes, that is the rapture, but it was happening all the time. And for those of you guys who don't know, like way back in the past when we're teaching the rapture, before Sun Tzu realized the deepest level of the rapture, he's talking about rapture means to reach a new level, to rapture higher. It means to be caught up, right? To go into the air. And in this, in the same way, if you look at from the, it's, you know, remember rapture is also resurrection. So to rapture means to go from servant to sons. To rapture means to go from sons to brides. Those are all raptures that are continuously happening. We're rapturing all the time, right? So a rapture, we're living kind of in what you call a rapturing history, right? We raptured to the level of children, raptured to the level of brides. So, you know, when you think about this, even the people at the time of the New Testament when Jesus came, they acted like kings for 2,000 years, rapturing to that level. And basically rapturing, you know, the fulfilling the purpose of creation is the rapture itself. And what is a rapture? Well, we have to love the Holy Trinity and our neighbors, right? At the ultimate level. And that's the purpose of creation. And that's happening at every time. So when Jesus came, he taught the words from 2,000 years ago to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, right? And that is something that is the purpose of creation. So even the people at the New Testament time when Jesus came, they were fulfilling the purpose of creation. Of course, not to the highest level, but they were fulfilling it, right? So we have to be those that take action on the words of God, especially when it comes to, and this is the most important one is, you know, loving, love Matthew 22, 37 to 40, which is to love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, right? And he says, like, you know, on average, sometimes we love and sometimes we fight with people, right? And that's not the full, that's not giving all your heart within life. Because if we did love that much, we would be able to continue to love, like, continuously. And that's something we have to think about when it comes to our family and friends with the Lord, with God, right? Can we love continuously? We have to love to that level with all our heart, with all our will and all our life, right? And I hope that, you know, we can, you know, this point is the one that I really love. Because when you think about this, Matthew 22, 37 to 40, It is the thing that every single person can do. Everyone can do it. It doesn't require a mission, doesn't require a title, doesn't require money, not even being mature, which means SS and campus can all do it too. This is the message for everyone, to be spiritual and divine, to be godly. What do we need, right? We just need to love with all our heart, will, and life, right? And if we, like, this is the thing. Sun Seam gave such a Shimjung-filled message. It's like, if you, you know, basically your fate will change if you, if something could change us from that message, right? He says, your fate will change if you can or cannot change by today's message, right? And basically, when Sun Seam was asking God about this, you know, basically, remember he says in the middle of the soccer field, he saw the sun with the ring rainbow around it. And the rainbow is the promise. It is the stamp. And if you love God with all your heart and love God for the rest of your life, God promises, right? God will promise to fulfill his end. That's God's promise. He will do it perfectly according to the promise. So that's why we saw the picture of it, which was quite amazing too, right? So, you know, if Sun Seam said that if you were to just give one message, it is the ultimate message is love God with all your heart within life. Try it. Not just trying it, like just trying it every once in a while or with half-heartedly. Try it with everything you have, right? Everyone wants to put all their life and best into something. So where are you going to put it, right? If you're just planting trees and rocks, they're only physical things, but it's best when you do what? It's best when you do it for God, loving God. There's no other thing better. So if you think about this, just loving God with all your heart within life, it translates and it basically goes into everything because you're doing it for God. Everything is being done for God, right? So if we think about this, it's quite amazing, right? So this, as he said, this is his favorite message, to love God with all your heart, will, and life. And it's very, very difficult to put the word into practice, but this is the, if there's only one thing, this is it. So guys, if we think about this, it's basically like verse 40 from Matthew 22, 37 to 40. Verse 40 says, every command can be summed up by these two laws, to love God and to love people with all your heart, will, and life. How difficult is this? Well, it's difficult, but you only need to focus on one thing. The ultimate thing, that's the purpose of creation, which is Matthew 22, 37, the ultimate verse in the Bible. If there's anything we're focusing on this week, is to love, right? It is difficult though, but at least we can only focus on one thing. It's as difficult as Sun Seam said in Vietnam, is where people are shooting you when you don't shoot back. That's how difficult it is. When you have the power to kill. You have the power to kill, but you don't do it. See, if you don't have the power to do it, then it's much different because, you know, you can just say it with your lips, right? That's the difference between people in Vietnam War and those who didn't go. People who went, who didn't go, can probably say, oh, you know, I would have been like Rambo and killed everyone. Oh, I could have done what Sun Seam did. But you were never there. So it's not even that powerful. And it's the same as David having the power to kill Saul twice, but he didn't. And that's why Saul gave in to him and says, you're a better man than I, because I would have killed, right? So God has given us the greatest commandment. So we have to look for the one who loves him the best, right? And what is rapture? Ultimately, it's this week's message. It is done by someone who keeps the greatest law of loving with all your heart, will, in life. We have to love that way, right? We have to love that way more than anything else. Right? There's so much, it's the most simplest way to put our life of faith. It's the simplest way. Many people listen, you know, gosh, if you think about this, yeah, when we teach this message, there is no other message that's greater than this. There's no other message. And he says that if you want to become like really, you know, and I think that was the key point more than anything else. That was the best point. I really loved it. And it brings your heart and mind back to where it should be, back to the beginning again, right? And it was kind of like recharging our battery. So we've received the word and we've accepted it and we've become spiritual. And, you know, receiving this word, something basically said, if you want to become spiritual divine, yeah, of course you have to believe in love. And when you receive that word and you receive that, receive the word and accept it, you are literally receiving God and you are becoming divine when you receive the words, right? So I hope that all of us here, we'll be able to love, to truly love. And the way Sun Seam put it was, even the word love, you cannot express everything with that word. Because there are so many, like, it's like 50 to 70 different kinds of love. Sun Seam said, putting the word to practice is love, obeying is love, trusting is love. There's so many different types of love. And you can't just explain it with just one word, love God. And there's 50 to 70 things. So I think it's a good exercise for a lot of people to start writing down the different types of love, right? Being patient. Like if you look in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 from verse 4 and on, love is patient, love is kind. Like, these are all different types of love that we can find in the Bible. Right? When you talked about obeying, that's John 14, 15. If you love me, you'll obey me. All these things are there, and we just need to write them down more than anything else. When you truly love, right? When you truly, truly love, then Sanjeev said, you have graduated from the Bible. That is crazy. You've graduated the Bible if you can truly love. If you truly love, Satan cannot intervene. How many of us have wanted that more than anything else too? So we have to be those that truly love more than anything else, right? So when we love, then God can make providence according to his laws of love. And I think that's one of the things that we have seen problems with in churches or with leaders and followers is there true love, right? Is there true love more than anything else with all your heart, will, and life? And that's something that it made me think about my time as a head leader is, oh man, sometimes you forget that was a number one thing more than did you do this or did you do that, right? So if we can't, and this point here that Sunsi made was so powerful when he says, doing one thing with all your heart, will, and life, if you basically have to do everything that way, right? So the person who can love with all their heart, will, and life, that extreme are people that do it with a lot of different things. This is how the brain works. It's not like you can just do all heart, will, and life with one thing and not with other things. So you watch people how they lecture, watch people how they treat others, watch people how, and some people are extreme. They might seem a little bit negative, but you see how extreme they are. That's how much they can love. We can't just do one thing. It's something that we have to understand is it's loving or doing something with all your heart, will, and life. You have to be able to do other things too. So Sunsi was saying, if you can't clean with all your heart, will, and life or work properly, then how can you love God? Right? You're going to be at that level. And Sunsi basically talked about, yeah, doing 100% doesn't just mean doing that one thing because it's like grades. If you're good at prayer 100%, but then you're terrible at reading the Bible, you get an average score between the two, right? So it's something that we have to really, really figure out more than anything else, right? And we have to be those that understand God to that level. Right? And it's something where I was thinking about, yeah, like there's so much more from this message because the second part of the message is talking about, when Sunsi was asking God, like, hey, God, he asked God, how much are you literally with us? To what point are you intervening in human life? And to what point do you take action? Because I need to know when I take action too. And that's whole another section of the word. But we can't take away from that first part of the message, which is the most important one by far. Right? That is the ultimate secret of all things, right? Yeah, because, even for me, understanding how God works with me, right? Like God, basically God answered Sunsi in his heart saying that in order to fulfill his will, he has to come to the earth frequently because he has work to do himself, right? But people won't know he's there, right? Sometimes he's there in like literally, right? Sometimes he's there showing himself through fire like he did through Elijah. Sometimes he's there through, parting the Red Sea. He's there in many different ways, right? But God is always walking with us, right? He's always there with us. And the key point there was, regardless of how God is with us and he's there with us, and of course, that's an important point. The most important part is if you love God, if you love him with all your heart, will, and life, he will always walk with you. Always. That was the key, right? That was the key. Yes, it's really interesting to figure out to what point God and the Holy Spirit is with us. Does he actually walk with us? Or they're angels or errand runners, right? And of course, that's something that that is important for all of us to know. But more than anything else, it's about, do you love God? Because if you don't love God, there's no chance for God to even be with you. He won't even be with you, right? We have to love with all of our heart, will, and life, and God will be with us more than anything else. We have to pray properly, right? Coming to Warm Dome 2, something like going, you're not coming there to meet me. You're not going there to get some water. You're going there for God. This is God's house of prayer, right? It's God's house of prayer. Sunsi is the housekeeper, right? And he's making sure that everyone does things in the right way. You go there to pray, understanding God's shimjung, praying to God with all your heart, will, and life, right? And if you truly seek God, sometimes he said that God will come, angels will come, a person will come to tell you how much God loves you. Like, I'm going to tell you, even yesterday, when I was thinking about something yesterday, I don't even know what it was, but the only thing I remember, I was driving, and then as I was driving by, there was a church, there's a big sign right in front of my face that says, God loves you. And I was like, wow, God, thank you so much. And that was God speaking to me at that time. I was like, wow, God was there, right? And we have to realize right now, living in this history, we are in the most amazing time. If we truly love the Holy Trinity, God will never throw us away. God will never not forgive us. We're going to make mistakes. Look at David. David was so amazing, and he made some terrible mistakes. But even then, God never stopped taking him back because of that love for God. What's the difference between him and Saul? Him and Saul both made mistakes. But David loved God with all of his heart, soul, mind, and strength. And yes, he made mistakes, but he loved God so much. Right? And we have to get to that level. Right? We really need to get to that level. God will never throw away those that love with all their heart, will, and life. Right? God will always pay attention to us. Right? And we need to be those that realize how much the love God has for us, that if we complete it, it is the ultimate thing to God more than anything else, right? We need to be that close. So this is a time right now, I really love that. This last point I want to bring up, there's so much in the message, but just not enough time to go over all of it, was how much we need to be close to the Holy Spirit, because right now is the time the Holy Spirit is on the earth. And the moment the man of mission is gone, then the Holy Spirit is gone too. So we have to realize how much we need to just spend this time, like literally having face-to-face talk. Not like it's going to, think about this, guys. After the man of mission is gone, what's going to happen? The Holy Spirit is still here, but not literally like, you know, like it is right now, which means spend this time in the best way where you can be face-to-face, like literally with the Holy Spirit right now. You have to be like that, because they won't get a chance like this in the future, only now. Guys, there's so many things that something made us realize, right? And we have to change. Because if we don't change after a message like this, it's going to be very difficult to change later, step by step, little by little. Don't expect these huge changes to happen, right? We can't live just the way we want, right? We can't live the way we want. We have to live the way that God has called us to live. And it is so incredible that we're living in a time that we're meeting with God. We're meeting the one that God has sent, right? This is such a valuable time that we're living in right now. And we have to be those that are very sharp and detailed, like the Holy Spirit. And remember, the Holy Spirit said that only 30% of the people know that when the Holy Spirit is directly with them. And we have to realize we're becoming dull and not spiritual. So meeting God and the Holy Spirit is the eternal blessing, because when we meet them, we will never die. Right? That's mind-blowing. Right, it really is. And we have to become those that love that deeply. And we need to be those, as we learn, to learn how much God participates in human lives. Right? We have to learn that much. So I hope that all of us here, well, you know, there's just too many things in the message that I skipped. But it was just that main point that I wanted to bring up more than anything else. That main point, all right? So that is the word study. A little bit long today, well, because the message was that powerful, all right? So this is the end of the word study. Hope you guys really enjoyed this. Have an amazing time. I'm going to go into the song of choice for today. And I usually go into the Filipino singers and foreign singers. And tomorrow is usually Korean singers. But today I'm going to pick a duet. And this song is from, I believe, all the way in the 90s or the early 2000s. And it's a duet between Jackie Chung, who's like the king of, who's a king of pop in, or king of singers in Hong Kong. And then Regine Velasquez, which is, she's the queen of singing over there in the Philippines. And they did a song together. And it's called I Will Always Love You. It's considered one of the most popular Asian songs ever. And so this is the Philippines and Hong Kong singers combined in this duet, I Will Always Love You. Hope you guys will enjoy it. And it fits perfectly with the Sunday message.
Just a gentle whisper. Tell me that you're gone, leaving only memories. Where did we go wrong? I couldn't find the words then, So let me say then now, I'm still in love with you.
Tell me that you love me, tell me that you care, tell me that you need me, and I'll be there, I'll be there waiting. I will always love you, I will always take you, there's no one who loves you like I do.
Come to me. I'm in love with you. Now we're here together. Yesterday has passed. Life is just beginning. Close to you at last, and I promise to you I would always be there. I give my all to you.
Live a life without you is more than I can bear. Hold me close forever.
That is Jackie Chung and Regine Velasquez from Hong Kong and the Philippines with that great song, I Will Always Love You. Their first language obviously is not English, but great, great. I used to sing this at karaoke all the time by myself, doing both parts. I don't know why. I just love this song. Either way, so I hope you guys really enjoyed that, which means we're going to get into the last segment today. And of course, every Mondays we have Korean on the go with Preston Lewis. He's American, now living in Korea. He's been studying Korean for 9 years already, and he's already translating too. So everyone, please enjoy another segment of Korean on the go.
What's up, everyone? This is Preston Lewis back with another episode of Korean on the Go. I'm here once again to help you guys learn Korean. I'm coming to you once a week with language learning tips and tricks. You may be thinking, can I really learn Korean? Yes, you can. You just need the willingness to learn, and as always, I am here to help you with the how. So guys, we're already on our fifth week of Korean on the Go. Last week I shared with you guys the main method that I use to study Korean, and that has been studying with the word. This is great because we're always receiving new words, and the word is always accompanied with translation, so it's very easy to study. It's very easy to learn new words. So guys, doesn't matter what level of Korean you're in, this is useful. If you're a very beginner, you can start with just memorizing titles. Then once you get comfortable memorizing titles, then you can move to shorter proverbs. Then you can slowly move to longer proverbs. Then you can start to look at entire proverb sets. Then you can look at entire messages. Now this week, as I said last week, I told you that I wanted to talk about dictionaries. Now dictionaries are a very, very necessary tool in learning a language because there's going to be a lot of words you don't know, and you're going to be having to look those words up. Now the great thing about using the word to study is that it's already translated into English, so you pretty much just have to match words you don't know. That being said, there may be several words in a given sentence that you don't know, so you may not be sure which English word matches with it. In these kinds of cases, of course, you need to use a dictionary to look up those missing words. So the dictionary that I use and would highly recommend is called the Naver Dictionary. That's Naver, N-A-V-E-R. Now, Naver is basically like a Google that's used in Korea. So on your computer, if you type in Naver Dictionary, it'll pop up. It'll be the first thing, and you can select English. I also recommend having an app, a dictionary app, on your phone, because when you're on the go, it's very convenient to just be able to pull your phone out and look up a word. For the phone, too, there's the Naver Dictionary app, which I recommend. So if you type in Naver Korean Dictionary, it should pop up. It'll definitely pop up for Apple. I believe it should pop up for Android as well. The nice thing about Naver Dictionary is that you can make an account connected to your email and you can save the words that you've looked up. So you have this word search history. So now, with all dictionaries, when you type in a word, it'll give you, you know, a few possible meanings. That is to say, based on the context the word is used in, there's different connotations, so that's why there's different definitions. The great thing about Naver Dictionary is that it has a ton of examples of the words being used in sentences. Remember, I emphasized the importance of context when learning languages. So it has the sentences in both English and Korean. So I always read several examples, and I think that helps me to sort of pinpoint, sort of like GPS, kind of triangulate what that meaning is, like what the feeling of that word is, and what the context of how that word is used is in Korean. Now, this is sort of an advanced skill, but as you guys are feeling up to the task, I encourage you to look at the words, how they're used in context. So one more thing I want to say, which is related to this idea of looking up words and using dictionaries. Don't think you have to memorize a word the first time you see it. I think when we're first learning a language, you see a new word and you just like rack your brains trying to just burn it in your mind. I think it's sort of an instinct for us when we're learning a new language. But when we're learning a language, we really have to see a word several times before it registers as important in our mind. So for me, if I'm looking up a word for the first time, it's usually just to fill the blank of the sentence, right, for the meaning, just so that I know what it's talking about. But it's very rare that I'll try really hard to commit that word to memory the first time I see it. And that's true for the second time and third time too. It's rare that I'll memorize a word after just seeing it two or three times. If you give yourself a few times of seeing and hearing a word, then you'll naturally be able to see which words you need to memorize. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if you're seeing a word several times and having to look up a word several times, it means that that's how important that word is. I'll give you an example. If you're reading Proverbs, you're going to quickly realize that there are words that you're seeing a lot that you're going to have to memorize as important in Providence. Marisim is the word. Hananim is God. Sarang is love. Junim is the Lord. Yong is the spirit. Hugo is rapture. So you're going to see these words appear multiple times all over many different messages. So you're going to realize these are important words that I need to remember. And that frequent exposure is actually going to help commit it to your mind. But what's the problem is that if you forcibly try to memorize words the first time you see them, what happens is you end up memorizing some important and useful words, but you end up memorizing some words that are uncommon and that are somewhat unuseful. You're probably not going to hear that word again for a long time. And if you don't hear it for a long time, you'll probably have forgotten it by the time you hear it again. So that's why I want to encourage you guys to not kill yourself over memorizing a word the first time you see it, but look it up. Say, okay, I got it. But recognize that you're probably not going to remember it the next time you see it, but that in that process of looking up that same word 2, 3, 4 times, eventually you're going to see, this is an important word. You're going to feel that, and your brain is going to be able to remember it that much more readily. So these are the main things I wanted to share with you guys today. The first was to be sure to have a good dictionary on hand, on your computer and on your phone. And the second point I made today was not to stress over memorizing words the first time you see them, but that the important words will come up a lot, you'll be looking them up a lot, and you'll naturally get that familiarity, and the memorization will happen more naturally. So guys, I hope that this has been helpful. Hope you're enjoying the show so far. Next week, there's something I want to talk about, and it's something that the majority of people overlook when they're learning a language. So you might find it surprising what it is, but stay tuned next week and I will share with you what that thing is. As always, guys, please comment and let me know if there are any questions you might have or any particular topics you'd like me to talk about in this show. As always, this has been Preston Lewis with Korean on the Go. This is the place for you to get weekly tips and tricks on learning the language. I learned Korean by doing this. And you can too. So until next week, everyone, keep watering that seed.
And there you have it. Thank you so much, Preston Lewis, over there in Korea. He's American in Korea. That sounds like a movie, An American Werewolf in Korea. Oh, sorry, either way. Thank you so much, Preston. Awesome episode. This was my favorite one by far. Thank you so much for doing these Korean on the Goes, and I know that a lot of people are benefiting from it. Guys, go ahead, give your appreciation in the comments below. I know that Preston would appreciate that too. Thank you guys so much for this awesome, awesome Monday. Hope you guys enjoy the day, and then we will see you guys again tomorrow. Yeah, it's Monday, guys. Can't believe Monday's already here, right? This is Sky signing off over here in Los Angeles in my uncle's house. Hope you guys had an amazing podcast today, and we'll see you guys again tomorrow on the Morning Star Drive on 117.8.
It's the Morning Star Drive 117.8. You soaring up with Sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know. I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know.